Well, we'll be asking you lots of things about a year you'd probably rather forget. We hope you enjoy the show tonight because, unfortunately, this is the last ever Big Fat Quiz. Before World War III. OK, let's meet the teams. First up, she's from North of the Wall and he's Nerd Stark. It's Sarah Millican and David Mitchell. Next, not just a great team, but also a hell of a score in Scrabble, it's Romesh, Ranganathan and Mel Giedroyc. And finally, one was crowned the funniest person on Twitter, the other finished fourth in Heat magazine's Weird Crush poll. It's Rob Delaney and Richard Ayoade. OK, good year for you, Richard, was it?
I mean, it happened. it was... I can't... Yeah, I mean, it was all right. I mean, it's over. Now.
It's been lovely chatting.
Yeah.
Rob, obviously, America, did it... I mean, I don't know what your politics are. Bad year, good year for you?
For America, abysmal. Real bad. A lot of people voted the wrong way, it turns out. Yeah. More people voted for Clinton, as we know, but a smaller number voted incorrectly, and then that person won somehow. So
it's a great system you've got,
isn't it?
Yeah. This wishy-washy liberal. I'm going to hear this all night.
Let's go to Mel. Did you have a good 2016?
It was absolutely cracking. Marvellous. Every month rolled by better than the last.
Bloody amazing.
May was really good. May was a cracker. August, even better than May. And as for November, it was so brilliant.
Have you just learnt the months?
I've learnt the months.
Romesh, you went to America with your mum this year. How was that?
Well, my mum coming with me is an unfortunate side effect of her being a success of the first series. So it wasn't ideal. You know, I love my mum, but I wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't want to spend 6 weeks with her, but I had to because I want exposure. So I did do that. It was annoying, but we managed to get through it. We're still talking.
How did your dad feel about you?
He said, Romesh, I've been dead for 3 years.
It's a fair comment, I would say, yeah. I did not know that.
A really...
What a great start to the show, though.
The really great interviewers, Jimmy, like, yeah, you know, Parkinson's, they do a bit of research.
Oh, it makes me feel so happy that you did that. It's so
cool. Walk right in. This looks fine. There's no bear trap here. Hang on. Sarah, how's your year been? I know you've been on a massive tour, haven't you?
Yeah, I'm just wondering which of my relatives are going to guess it, who was alive and who was dead. Yeah, I've been on tour. It's been fun. I'm glad to be in one place now. And also, it's been a good year because I didn't get pregnant, which is good.
Well, I mean, you're with David Mitchell this evening, so just be careful is all I'd say.
We are both married to other people, and that's not a very Christmassy suggestion.
And it's not the least Christmassy thing that's happened so far. David, so how's your year been? You play Shakespeare, of course, this year.
I did, yeah, in a sitcom. I dressed up as him.
I saw that. It must have been nice to have a little refresh of your wardrobe.
There we go. Given time, my hair will go like that. And maybe then I'll get some respect round here.
Right, on with the show. The first round is all about the headlines of 2016, so let's remind ourselves of some of the year's biggest stories. Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump were the two most unpopular presidential candidates in history. For many Americans, it was like trying to pick between a punch in the face and a kick in the balls. Both are terrible options, but one is clearly worse for future generations of children. In the end, a TV celebrity with super white teeth, who's always saying controversial things and pays no tax, has been elected to high office. This is my time. In June, the British public were asked to decide whether we should stay in the EU or leave. To put that in context, that's the same British public who kept Honey G in X Factor week after week. Well, let's get started with some questions. OK, first up, Donald Trump famously branded Hillary Clinton Crooked Hillary, but what were the nicknames he gave to his Republican rivals Ted Cruz, Marco Rubio and Jeb Bush?
Oh, hello.
I need all three for a point.
That's what I would do.
Man, you got to write tiny.
I really do.
OK, next. It wouldn't be a Big Fat Quiz if we didn't have the children of Mitchell Brook Primary School performing one of their unconventional school plays. Have a look at this and tell me what news story they're acting out here.
All aboard to Newcastle! There are no seats! Why are you sitting on the floor? This train's too busy, that's why we should have all the trains. You're a liar! There are lots of seats! But they're for other people!
We want to sit together.
You can sit here. Why did you sit on the floor?
Oh, no!
I can tell you that is not Fidel Castro. So you've got to tell me what news story they were acting out there. Britain voted to leave the EU in a referendum. On the morning after the vote, what did a jubilant Nigel Farage demand?
Demanded.
Oh, yeah. The day after. OK, next question. In a bid to improve the image of his company, Sports Direct boss Mike Ashley took journalists on a tour of his warehouse, but he was filmed pulling out of his pocket something whilst at security. What was it?
Yeah. Yes. Trainers, no.
OK. A final question in this round. It's over to Professor Green.
Ah.
Hello, Jimmy. 2016 was a huge year for casting a vote, but there was one poll in particular that really caught my attention. A competition to name the UK's new polar research ship was launched, and the winning name was announced as Boaty McBoatface. But thankfully, that wasn't the name they decided to go with in the end. Nope. Can your teams remember what they called it instead?
Oh, what do you think? What is this?
What boat was it? It was Boaty McBoatface.
Yes, what was it? It was a boat.
It was an actual boat.
That's the answer to the question, is what you're asking now.
It's the name of the boat. You can't go.
You're going, which boat was it? What was the boat? Just tell me the name of the boat and I'll name the boat.
Was this a boat on water or was it another?
What kind of fucking boat do you think it was?
It was a gravy boat. It was a scientific research gravy boat.
Oh, I love a gravy boat.
So it's nice, a gravy boat, but you've got to sea in a gravy boat and it won't end nicely because, A, you'll get gravy all over you and, B, it'll sink.
All right, you ready for some answers?
Yes, ma'am.
OK, excellent news. All right. So, first up, I asked you the nicknames Trump gave to his Republican rivals. What have you put, Romesh and Mel?
We put... For Ted Cruz, put Father Ted, Father. Marco, Polo. Bushy, Kate.
David, Sarah, what did you get?
Well, for Ted Cruz, we've put non-gay Cruz. it's just not gay. That's the main thing.
Non-gay Cruz, right. Good.
That's all they're saying. All Trump is saying is that he's not gay. It's not a reference.
And then for Rubio, we've got Rubio's Cube. See what we did?
Oh, yeah. That's good.
Because he's a bit of a square. No.
That is good.
And then for Jeb Bush, we thought 70s Bush. You know, just because it sounds fun.
It does sound fun.
Thinking back to, you know, happier times.
Yeah.
When you were allowed to have pubes.
You're still allowed to.
Sarah,
it's sort of don't shunned.
No, it's come back in.
Is it come back in?
Yeah.
Oh, thank God for that.
I have a pair of shorts down there. Seriously, if you imagine what's going on here on Romesh's face.
I don't need
to know. Sorry, Dad. I can see those things.
Look at Romesh's little face.
Sorry,
I had no idea that Mel's vagina was Sri Lankan.
Okay. What did you guys get, Rob, Richard?
For Lion Ted, he called him Lion Ted Cruz.
That's exactly right, yes.
And then for Marco Rubio, he called him Little Marco.
That is exactly correct.
And then, this isn't as catchy, but he called Jeb Bush, he called him low energy all the time.
And not Ronnie Corbett.
Not Ronnie Corbett. Because Jeb Bush isn't funny.
Well, you are 3 for 3 there. Exactly correct on all three. Fine work. fine work.
Strong.
So you did a lot of Trump trolling, didn't you?
I'll troll him from time to time, sure. I'm not a fan.
I tweeted him, right? He didn't reply. Mm-hmm. I tweeted him, but honestly, this is what happened. My timeline blew up with Trump supporters sort of replying to me. One of them said to me, "Go blow a goat, you curry-munching prick." And do you know the worst thing? I was eating a curry. I was like, Jesus Christ, is he in the garden? What the shit's going on, man?
Could have been worse, though, if you'd been blowing a goat. You saw the children of Mitchell Brook Primary School. What do you think they were acting out?
Jeremy Corbyn on a train.
OK. Rob, Richard, were you aware of this?
Yeah. Were you straight up fat Corbyn on the train floor?
Well, pretty well. Romesh, Mel, did you get this?
We did get it.
We did.
Mel crossed out because she said this is so boring, this answer, but it is actually the correct answer. It is...
Yeah.
He pretended...
Corbyn. Mm-hmm. Corbyn. You say. Corbyn. He present. Yeah.
Yeah.
He pretended to her. Go. Say.
He pretended.
So to have no seat. You say.
He didn't have a seat. On the.
Quicker, Romesh.
On the train.
The train.
Well done, Romesh. There, you really nailed that. I asked you what Nigel Farage demanded the morning after the EU referendum. What did you put?
We put dead Poles and Asians.
Nigel Farage demanded the next day dead Poles.
Yeah, and then I reckon he put them all in his dining table and he ate sushi off them. Celebration of what he'd achieved. What a bell end.
He clearly didn't ask for that. Rob, Richard, did you get this?
That all after cease, sushi, a helicopter and mercy.
Just in case it's the correct answer, this wasn't a demand though, but he said, "You all laughed at me when I came in here, but you're bloody well not laughing now." That's my Farage. And
that is uncanny. Well,
thank
that
you.
Is
I've
really...
studied it.
But... I'm not sure if uncanny means what you think it means. Okay, well that's not right. That's not right.
We think he demanded his life back.
He did say that, but he didn't demand that.
Isn't that in the tone, though?
Oh, well, take a look at this.
June the 23rd needs to become a national bank holiday, and we will call it Independence Day.
Yeah! Is that a demand or just a lovely off-the-cuff suggestion?
You've gone surprisingly right-wing this year. OK, I asked you what Mike Ashley pulled out of his pocket when talking to journalists on a tour of Sports Direct. What did you put?
We put a Nazi memorabilia. Because that's never good to fall out of your pocket. That should always be, like, in a secure bag.
Yeah. People immediately jump to conclusions, don't they?
Yeah. Sometimes you just look nice in the hat, you know?
Yeah. OK. Rob, Richard, what did you get?
Quite a bit of co-production here. Some of it I can't read.
Oh, the first one's an effigy of Satan. But, I didn't start with the capital.
Shot in the dark, I said a bag of eels.
Yeah, eels, bag of. And biscuits. Because that would be gross.
Eels and biscuits. That's not the answer. Romesh, Mel? No.
We put a massive wad of cash.
A massive wad of cash? Well, let's have a look.
I'm just going to look at the trophy. I'm on
search.
Yeah, no problem.
A lot of cash there.
A lot of cash. Yes, I've been to the casino. Now, don't please write that.
Yes, Mike actually was on a tour of his warehouse, telling the journalist how great he was to his staff, and then just, yeah, there you go.
And then, in explanation, it's all right. I'm not dodgy. I've been to the casino.
OK, finally, Professor Green asked you the name eventually given to Boaty McBoatface, and there's a clue. It wasn't Boaty McBoatface, Mel. What did you put?
Janet.
Is that a guess?
Yeah. Who gives a shit? What I mean is, they pretended it was going to be a democracy. They pretended they were going to call it Boaty McBoatface. You know, they were going to call it whatever the people wanted. The people spoke, and then they dicked on it. So, do you know what? Screw whatever they called it. They're full of shit, and I hope the boat sinks. For them not responding and listening to the people. I hope it's sinky McSink. Fuck off.
Rob, Richard, Richard, what did you think Boaty McBoatface was called?
Well, I don't think this was a good idea, but it's correct, this answer, and it is what the people voted for. And I am shocked that they decided to go with HMS Ramesh's dead dad.
Hug it through.
Although that would be quite an honour.
I can tell you that is not the answer. David, Sarah, what did you go with?
Well, we thought that it's we thought it's actually named after David Attenborough.
I thought maybe Shitty McShitface. Like maybe they just ramped it up a bit.
I can tell you are 100% right with the first half of that. It is the RRS Sir David Attenborough.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, I told
her. Oh, okay. He's kicking off.
I just think it's a dreadful name for a boat.
I'm 100% with you. It's an awful name, isn't it? Janet is a great name.
Yeah.
Until it sinks. A lot of people have, you know, 12 seamen have gone down on Janet. Sounds awful.
Why? Worse than Sir David Attenborough?
12 seamen have gone down on Sir David Attenborough. Sounds... I hadn't thought it through.
My favourite episode of Planet Earth.
The scores are, David and Sarah have 2 points, Romesh and Mel have 2 points. In the lead so far, Rob and Richard with 4 points. Join us after the break when we'll be asking more questions than Keith Vaz's wife. Welcome back to the Big Fat Quiz of the Year 2016. This round is all about music. Let's remind ourselves of some of 2016's greatest hits. We lost some iconic musical heroes in 2016. David Bowie, Prince, Leonard Cohen. Although, if you're watching Nickelback, don't feel obliged to hang on our account. Honey G was the standout act on this year's X Factor. We've seen contestants with tragic backstories before, but Honey G took it to the next level by having a tragic past, present and future. Right, time for some more questions. Earlier in the year, Kanye West took to Twitter to ask Facebook founder Mark Zuckerberg for a favour. He claimed it would be one of the coolest things Mark would ever do. I just want to know, what did Kanye ask Mark Zuckerberg for? I think it's a big ask. A pretty big ask. For our next question, it's over to the Channel 4 newsroom and the one and only Jon Snow, who's reporting on one of this year's biggest songs. Can you guess which one?
The World Health Organization has warned of a possible pandemic following reports that a man in his mid-30s was admitted to hospital with symptoms that included hot blood and an unspecified feeling inside his bones and a severe burning pain in the groin region that he compared to having sunshine in his pocket. Doctors described the man's condition as electric and wavy and confirmed that traces of the mystery disease had been found in the air and in his blood. In a statement, the man expressed his fear that if the mystery disease is indeed airborne, it could spread all through his city, as well as all through his home. Though currently in quarantine with the room on lock, patient Zero remains in good spirits, insisting that although he is unable to stop the sensations, he would urge fellow sufferers to keep dancing. Tests are ongoing. Back to you, Jimmy.
Thank you, John. David Mitchell, just write down which popular hit that was. Couldn't be simpler, this one, really.
Fine, yeah.
Because of all the clues.
The one he was alluding to.
Well, regarding all the clues in the lyrics. So just write that down. Yeah. Okay, in April, a lyric from a song left everyone asking, who on earth is Becky with the good hair? Can you remember why?
Well, the correct answer from me would be no. Will you accept that we'd get the point for that, right? If this is just a test of memory, David hasn't failed. Yeah. Because if the question is, can you remember why, I also... I mean, I didn't know. So it's not like I forgot. Yeah. OK.
Hang on, Sarah's good.
Sarah,
have
you got... Do you know this one?
I think I do.
OK.
Sarah's filled this screen with inexplicable words and letters, which gives me a very optimistic feeling about our points haul.
OK. Next is over to the stars of the new movie in cinemas now, Why Him? It's Bryan Cranston and James Franco.
Wow.
Oh,
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Jimmy. Now, we love a good sing-along as much as anyone, and when we're on the set, we love nothing more than blaring out the tunes and all joining in.
This year, it was music to our ears when one very famous song written in the 19th century was officially recognized as being in public domain.
But can your teams tell us what classic tune it was?
Brian and James want to know what song was officially recognized as being in the public domain this year. Finally, I want to know who's singing this. Keep going, I love it. Hear me now.
No. Okay. All five correct.
All five correct, do you think, Mel?
Sorry.
Well, you just said
say that.
All five correct, yes.
That was so smug, I'm sorry.
Okay, so you ready for some answers? All right, let's have it. Okay, so I think probably over to David for this one. What did Kanye ask Mark Zuckerberg for over Twitter?
We thought the answer was lots of money.
Okay, Romesh, Mel?
Yeah. He asked for money to finance his creative ideas, and he said he's in, like, $53 million of debt or something.
OK, and Rob, Richard?
Swap T-shirts.
And also money.
And also money. But swap T-shirts.
Well, yeah, you're all right. Kanye West asked Mark Zuckerberg for $1 billion.
As I say, lots of money.
David, are you a big fan of Kanye's music?
I must have heard it, like, around.
You know, Gold Digger? Sort of... Gold Digger? And that song?
I've often heard a song when people say that's a famous song, but I'm quite bad at hearing lyrics. So it's just like a noise. I mean, oh, no, it's like a tune, but it's like I don't hear the words.
I like the way that you're saying tune in a totally different context to anyone in a club going tune.
I really don't understand what you did. I mean, what does it mean to go tune?
Just, it means it's a good song, I guess.
It's like recognition. Tune.
Yeah.
Tune.
Would you, would you say as casually as that?
Tune.
Tune.
But more than that. Give it more significance. I have noticed that there is a tune.
OK, Jon Snow reported on one of the year's biggest songs. Romesh, what did you think?
We think it was Justin Timberlake's It Can't Fight, Can't Stop the Feeling.
Possible Feeling.
OK, we'll give you that. What did you get, Rob, Richard?
We went with Airborne Love Explosion. Based on the description.
David, Sarah, what did you put?
Well, I thought it was Justin Timberlake, the same as those guys, Can't Stop the Feeling, but David thought it might be something to do with the baller.
You thought it might be something to do with the Ebola virus?
Well, there seemed to be quite a very strong viral theme in the way he was talking about it.
Well, that's what we put, and he really mocks it.
The man's a serious journalist, isn't he?
Yeah.
So, also, he said he's got sunshine in his pocket, which suggests some sort of really hideous sort of burning rash, do you know what I mean, like, around the genital area.
Let's go back to John for the answer. Okay, it was Can't Stop the Feeling by the one and only Justin Timberlake. Of course,
lovely.
It bloody was. Okay, I asked you why everyone was talking about Becky with the good hair. What have you written there, Rob?
That says, why were they asking? Because Beyonce sang about it. Can't get more specific than that. Don't know the name of the song, but that's the correct answer.
That I will give you that. What did you get, Romesh, Mel?
We put Lemonade, Beyonce controversy.
Basically, in Lemonade, Beyonce refers to Becky with the good hair, and people speculated that that was the woman that Jay-Z was cheating on Beyonce with. Some people thought it might be Rita Ora.
Although her name isn't Becky.
But no, okay. But they thought they'd use a different name, because otherwise it's massively obvious, isn't it? If you say Rita Ora, you don't even have to specify what her hair's like. People go, that is definitely Rita Ora she's talking about.
Yeah, you can't deny
first name, surname and national insurance number for the avoidance of doubt. But
so Rita Ora can never be used as a metaphor?
Never.
That's what we're saying.
No, it always means Rita Ora.
Oh, fuck.
So
we've got the same as those guys. The Lemonade album by Beyonce had a song on that was alluding to an affair. and that was still exactly the same as
it's exactly right. Yeah, it was the lyric on the track Sorry that read, he only want me when I'm not there, he better call Becky with a good hair.
She still says she's got good hair, yes. Even though she's like banging her husband. It's
well,
nice
that's
that,
because
isn't it?
He was also banging this girl Becky that had no hair. So
well, I suppose for Jay-Z that means he has around 100 problems now. Nice.
That's very good. That yeah. is very good.
Are you calling her?
I don't get it. I don't get it, but I believe that it's a functional joke.
Thank you, David. It means a lot to me. Jay-Z famously has 99 problems, but a bitch ain't one.
Yeah. Are you and calling now... her? Sorry, Jimmy, did you just call Beyonce?
No, I called... No. I called... No! You no. Just... I called Becky with a good
you
hair.
Just started a war. You just started a war between me, B, and you and Jay-Z.
You can't help but rhyme.
That's right.
Rap-a-doodle-doo.
That's right.
Bryan Cranston and James Franco asked you what very famous song became part of the public domain this year. What did you get?
Happy Birthday.
Happy Birthday.
Happy Birthday.
Wasn't it originally Good Morning to You?
It that, was originally yeah. Good Morning to All. It was written to by all. Two teachers, their sisters, Mildred and Patty Hill. You can have a look at them.
They don't look like the sort of women that make up that song. They look like they make up a song, Piss Off, I Hate You.
Yeah, so that's now in the Happy Birthday's now in the public domain.
So we can all sing it. We can all sing it for free.
You can all sing it for free. You can sing it now.
We can sing it for free.
You would be allowed.
Yeah. But suddenly now we're allowed. Where's the fun?
Yeah.
You used to feel dangerous.
Yeah.
You used to get excited. I'd get a semi just thinking about singing it.
Yeah.
Okay. Lastly, I asked you who was singing this little ditty. Richard, what did you put?
Oh, Rob. You knew.
David Cameron.
Yeah.
David
oh.
Cameron.
Oh!
What?
What's I thought we were going to be the only ones that got that.
I didn't.
You knew. It is David Cameron, isn't it? We got David Cameron. Mitchie, did you get...
Well, yeah, we got David Cameron also. Yeah.
Shall we take a look? Let's take a look.
So we'll have a new Prime Minister in that building behind me by Wednesday evening. Thank you very much. Right.
So it's a lovely little tune. It's a tune that says, yeah, you sort out this fucking mess I've put us in. Not my problem anymore. So points all round there. You've got David Cameron. So at the end of that round, the scores are David and Sarah have 7. Romesh and Mel have 7. In the lead, Rob and Richard with 8. Join us after the break when I'll be asking the question, why are celebrities so bad at quizzes? See you in 5. Welcome back to the Big Fat Quiz of 2016. Our next round is all about film and TV. Strictly Come Dancing dominated the ratings this autumn. Sadly, this was Len Goodman's last Strictly. The 72-year-old judge is leaving Strictly to spend more time with his Undertaker.
Jumping ship.
I always wanted to walk off a show.
Oh, she's all tucked in, don't worry. When the Great British Bake Off left the BBC, some people worried they wouldn't be able to replace Mary Berry, but there are loads of great names in the running. Mr. Kipling, Aunt Bessie and Greg from Greg's. Westworld showed us a future featuring incredibly lifelike synthetic androids. It was almost impossible to tell real humans from us. Sorry, then. OK, let's remind ourselves of some of the TV highlights of the year.
On my mark, get... Nah, I'll just go.
And here he goes. Very confident.
So expensive. Yeah.
The geezer's got a drawbridge. Hell.
Telly. OK, you just saw a snippet of Danny Dyer tracing his ancestry on BBC's Who Do You Think You Are? On his journey, he met a lord, visited Hampton Court Palace and declared that he wanted to buy a ruff. Can you name one of the unlikely well-known historical figures he was related to?
Pat Butcher.
You think you might be related to Pat Butcher?
Yeah, I do think that, yeah. She's okay. Fucking Pat. She's amazing, Pat.
Okay.
Did you read his 9/11 tweet?
Okay, yeah, what did he say?
He said, I can't believe it's been 11 years since them slags flew into that building, or something like that. It still does my nut in to this day. Wow. I can't quote it exactly verbatim.
What a lovely tribute.
Yeah, them slags.
OK, so who was Danny Dyer related to? Noel Edmonds hit the headlines this year after claiming he was able to cure disease with a special box. Yeah. He also set up another free service for the public. What was it?
I don't know.
He's looked exactly the same since 1980. It's quite incredible.
I think it would be disturbing to the nation if he suddenly changed his look. Don't you?
Yeah.
You know, you don't take the cock off the cornflakes, that's what I say.
And that's why you're not allowed to do breakfast anymore.
Yeah. Hang on, this milk's off. OK, next it's over to teen heartthrobs, the Vamps, David's favourites.
Hi, Jimmy! Hey. This year, it was impossible to avoid popular sci-fi horror Stranger Things.
Mm. Everyone was talking about the town of Hawkins, Eggo Waffles.
And, of course, the leading lady, Eleven.
Yes, but the best thing for me was the strange parallel dimension that featured. Can you tell us what it was called?
They've got very different core body temperatures, haven't they? They just can't get it right. That must be a nightmare travelling together. I want the air conditioning. It's bloody hot. There's something wrong with you, I think.
A new Sky One show this year was looking for dogs willing to go the extra mile, willing to problem solve and to investigate how to work something out for themselves. All I want to know is, what task were the dogs in that new Sky One show asked to perform? Mel, it is almost certainly not whatever you're laughing at now. And finally, have a look at this picture of Mel B's guest appearance on Running Wild with Bear Grylls. All I want to know is, what's going on here?
Bear Grylls is shitting out Mel B. He ate her earlier on in the show, just to show that she's got good proteins, and then he thought, no, I'm going to pass her out now. Can we have a clue, please?
Yes, come on. We haven't had a clue all night yet.
I'd say it's not sexual for everyone, but there's certain, you know, certain folks. Right, you all got answers?
Yep.
Okay, first up, I asked you, who was Danny Dyer related to?
Well, we initially put Edward III, and then I quickly added Edward II and Edward I, who were related to Edward III, and therefore, by definition, were also related to Danny Dyer.
That is why you're a genius. It's a very good answer. Yeah, I'll give you that. Romesh, Mel, what did you put?
Thomas Cromwell.
Thomas Cromwell, also correct. Did you get this, Rob, Richard?
We said William the Conqueror. Edward II, and then since it's Danny Dyer, figured probably he's related to somebody named Jeff Dyer somewhere along the way.
Jeff.
Found to be a Jeff.
He's a diamond, Jeff.
Right, well, you all got that. William the Conqueror, Edward III, or Thomas Cromwell. I would have accepted you. Got them all. I asked you what service Noel Edmonds was offering. What did you think?
He drives a taxi, Noel Edmonds.
Right.
And he always has a mannequin in the passenger seat.
Right.
To make people think that he's got passenger.
OK.
So I just put down free taxi and mannequins.
True, but not the right answer. Rob, Richard, what did you put?
Lion taming.
No.
Talking clock and exorcisms.
OK, you're 3 for 3 wrong there. What did you go for, David and Sarah?
I've read this. I think it's a radio station for pets.
Oh, you're so...
But they can't turn it on. It's really sad because they've only got, like... They can't...
Well, I mean, the main thing is they can't turn it off. That's really cool.
Yeah, well, let's take a look.
What a lovely name you have, Donna. In addition to that wonderful Irish girl, Donna, who won the Eurovision Song Contest, I hope this is working, there's another very famous Donna, Queen Latifah, the rapper, singer, and film actress who received a Grammy for her role in Chicago. It's not her real name is Donna, just like yours, Donna.
Would the cat know who Noel Edmonds is?
Yes, we've told her. She's aware. And when we told her, she said, "I
Jeremy, seen Jeremy, pack it in, mate."
Yeah. What?
How long would
that's
you normally...
Cheap, that's a cheap one. Every animal in this country knows who I am.
Every animal in the country knows who I am. God, that's a cheap one. Come on, Terry. Who are you trying to kid? Every look at a field full of sheep. Every one of those sheep knows who Noel Edmonds is.
I just want to say that's the worst thing I've ever heard, and I would listen to it all day without interruption.
Next up, the Vamps asked you to name the parallel universe featured in Netflix hit series Stranger Things. What do you all put?
We just answered correctly. The Upside Down.
The Upside Down.
Yeah.
Rob, Richard, what did you put?
We put something that is
what
very
did you put?
Close to correct.
I haven't.
What was it, Rob?
The underneath.
The underneath.
Yeah, the underneath.
Okay.
Which I think like an 80-year-old. That's like what my grandfather. Oh, the underneath. But it isn't that.
Okay, Romesh, Mel.
We put Leatherhead. Have you been there? Not great shops.
Easy, I was born there, so...
There you go.
I asked you what task dogs were asked to perform on the new Sky One show. What did you put?
Fly a plane.
Fly a plane?
I think that was the end plan.
OK, and Romesh, Mel,
well,
did
listen,
you get this?
I didn't want to put this, but basically, Mel thought she knew what the question was going to be, so she put Jamie Theakston, because she thought you were going to ask who presented the show. And then you asked the rest of the question. She said, I'm still going with Jamie Theakston for some reason.
The dogs were asked to do Jamie Theakston.
Well, yeah, I mean...
And I watched that.
OK, Rob, Richard.
Baker, blackberry cobbler.
No, it is weirder than that.
No, I also put end racism.
Well, that would be great.
Did they
what,
do that?
David, Sarah, you got it right. Let's take a look.
Oh.
I think we'll all remember where we were the day that a dog took control of a plane.
Now, if that goes wrong, what's the insurance claim?
Who's at fault? Jamie Theakston.
Mm. Theakston.
I blame Jamie, yeah, 100%.
I did find myself hoping it would crash.
The dog wasn't doing that.
Yeah, but no,
the dog was just doing that.
Yeah,
it's just
that's how it flies a plane. What do you want to do? The announcements as well. Do you know what I mean? We're at 35,000 feet. The climate is pretty ropey.
That's just Captain Dog.
It's got to be something.
That was the best dog name you could come up with there. Did you come up with that?
I'll tell you what, Captain Dog. Improv, I'll tell you what, second to none.
Terrible.
This is Captain Dog.
Captain Dog. That's right. We'll be cruising at about 38,000 feet.
Why is he Scottish?
Yeah, they always are.
Okay, all right, so points, no points, no points. Okay.
Oh, this is going so badly.
I asked you what the deal was with this. David, Sarah, what did you put?
Well, I've written squeezing out some piss to drink. Because they do drink their own wee, like, even when he's at home, he does, I think. But David wrote wrestling a salmon.
They could have been wrestling, because they're next to a stream, they could be wrestling a salmon out.
Totally feasible.
OK. What do you think, Romesh, Mel?
Well, you gave us a clue that you said for some people it's sexual.
Yeah.
So we thought they were peeing, just weeing themselves for warmth, you know?
Well, you say we.
I thought they were weeing... Like, Mel B is weeing on... They're weeing on each other.
They're weeing on each other, OK. Yeah. Richard?
They're at the bottom of a stack of Spice Girls. It just keeps going up. David Beckham on the top, right. Selling whiskey or something.
Sure. Points, no points.
What?
Let's take a look.
So there you go, look, hold on. So those bits, I mean, it's...
The stingy bits.
It's slippery, but those are the... Those... Ow!
It got you?
Yeah, papa.
Do you need me to pee on you?
Let me see if I can do it.
No, I wanted
Ow.
To pee...
Ow! Mel's kindly offered two or three times to provide some urine. I had a pee about 10 minutes ago. I'm out. And I'm actually getting to the stage where I'm going to take her up on this offer. You take my hand, guide it.
Hold on, hold on. I'm going to pee on myself.
Are you ready?
To pee on demand when somebody's in pain is very difficult.
It's not coming!
Come on!
Yeah.
He
so obviously dropped it on purpose.
Yeah. He fumbled that jellyfish. That was like,
ooh. Oh, no, now I need you to pee on me.
It's just like, oh, no, I've smeared the jellyfish all over me. Oh, no. You're going to have to stand over here.
I also like that he says, after he finishes weeing, I'm out. I'm out. Yeah. I'm out of piss.
Oh, fully lost their mind. OK. Time now for a special bonus round. I'm going to show you some film posters from the year, which have all been subtly improved. All you need to do is tell me what the film is. Here's the first one. OK, just need the film.
OK.
OK, lovely. So there's the first one. Here's the second.
Lovely.
Nothing the matter with that. OK, and the third one.
Oh, hang on. Juno. Oh, no, that wasn't this one, was it?
That was a while ago.
Juno must have been 10 years ago now.
That was a decade.
That must have been 10 years ago.
When did you get to...
I know, Rosemary's Baby. Put that.
Rob and Richard, what were your three answers?
Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
I put
Ghostbusters.
Oh, yeah.
And The Revenant.
Ghostbusters, you thought the second one was?
Ghostbusters.
Okay. All right, so you got, what did you get?
Suicide Squad, Arrival, and then Revenant.
So Arrival, you thought was the big budget American sci-fi movie about a pregnant lady in a supermarket.
Listen, I haven't seen the film, but I put two together. I thought when a baby comes out of a JJ, that's an arrival.
What did you go for, Sarah?
Suicide Squad. I've written out Daniel Blake because I didn't know, but I've realised now what it is, that it's Bridget Jones's baby. But it's too late to change. And then Revenant.
OK, well, let's take a look. So the first one was me as Margot Robbie in Suicide Squad. You all got that. OK, second one was me as Renee Zellweger in Bridget Jones' Baby.
Yep.
And the final one, me as Leonardo DiCaprio in The Revenant.
Is that you? Oh, no, that's changed to him.
Well done, Mel.
That's the most flattering thing anyone's ever said to Jimmy. Is that you or Leonardo DiCaprio?
And that is the worst thing that's ever been said to Leonardo DiCaprio. Yeah. OK, so at the end of that round, the scores are... well, I can tell you, Romesh and Mel have 11, Rob and Richard have 11, but in the lead now, David and Sarah with 14. Join us after the break, otherwise it's just me shouting at celebrities. See you in five. Welcome back to the Big Fat Quiz. Our next round is all about the internet in 2016. All the things that caught my eye online that I'm prepared to admit to. The video sharing platform Vine was shut down. You might not think that's a big deal, but without anywhere to upload 6-second videos, how am I supposed to share my sex tapes? In 2016, Pope Francis not only became the first pope on Instagram, but also the first guy in Italy not to have his account suspended for posting dick pics. Some more big fat questions, everyone. First up, it's over to the brand new mayor of London, Sadiq Khan.
Aww. Hi, Jimmy. 2016 was a memorable year for me, the highlight of which was being elected the new mayor of London. But it was also a memorable year for a 40-year-old businesswoman, Liz Lyne, from New York, who woke up one day in February to find her name unexpectedly trending on Twitter as a result of something that happened here in London. Can your teams remember what it was?
Ooh.
OK. Sadiq Khan there asking why a 40-year-old American called Liz Lyne woke up one day to find her name unexpectedly trending on Twitter.
Is her being 40 important?
No.
OK.
Not at all.
It's just a bit of colour.
Gold medal-winning Japanese gymnast Kohei Uchimura got into a spot of bother at the Rio Olympics when he racked up a £3,700 phone bill. What I want to know is, what was he using his phone for that proved so costly?
Oh, I don't know.
So a Japanese gymnast at the Rio Olympics got a phone bill for £3,700. Why?
OK, good. I like it.
OK, have a look at this Facebook Live video starring Candace Payne from Texas, which went on to receive over 150 million views.
Hey, I'm really excited to share with you something I got. So you want to see what I got? It's so great. I can't wait to show you.
I want to know what she got.
Is it clapping Tourette's?
It's kind of clapping Tourette's. She is the most adorable woman, I think, of the year.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh.
She's, come on.
All over this.
Have you got this?
We've got the answer.
OK. Earlier this year, 86-year-old May Ashworth unsuspectingly found online fame after her grandson posted her Google search history online. Why?
Oh.
OK. Lastly, it's over to Zach and Ryan from One Republic.
Hey, Jimmy. We love social media, and there's nothing wrong with posing for a cheeky selfie, but somehow we failed to pick up on a new trend that hit Instagram this year.
Yes, apparently all the cool kids are taking pictures like this.
Or some of them actually are like kind of a little bit more like this. But can you tell me, Jimmy, what is this specific particular pose called?
Okay, so people are posing on Instagram with...
Oh, sorry.
Okay. You've got something?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Lovely. All right. So, Sadiq Khan asked you why Liz Line from New York found herself trending on Twitter. What do you think?
We think it's because of the Elizabeth Line in Crossrail that was named after Queen Elizabeth and might be shortened to Liz Line. And then that could be mistaken for a person called Liz Line. In a way that, in my view, is not worthy of further note.
It's 43 kilometres of tunnelling that has taken place underneath London, including going underneath the Thames. I went to a Crossrail lecture.
You love Crossrail?
I'm obsessed with Crossrail.
Why?
It's such a good thing. The journey currently from West Ealing into London, I would always give it...
Such a nightmare.
I'd always give it 45 minutes.
Yeah. You'd give 50.
45. 50. When Crossrail comes...
I'd give it 50.
Ladies and gentlemen, when Crossrail comes...
I would give it 50 minutes, though. Just
13 minutes, West Ealing into Thames Street.
13 minutes.
How long would you give it, Romesh?
I'd give it 15. I would say 15.
45.
No, but I would say... You're talking about 15 minutes there.
13 minutes. Once you're on the train.
When they put Crossrail through between Tottenham Court Road and the, I think it was the Piccadilly line, it was called Through the Eye of the Needle, ladies and gentlemen. They had centimetres.
Inches.
Centimetres.
What do you get?
We have new train line, QE2. I'm a messy writer, so I had to... It's correct.
100%. It was announced that Crossrail would be called the Elizabeth Line when it launched. I asked you why Japanese gymnast Kohei Uchimura was hit with a £3,700 phone bill in Rio. What did you put?
We put phoning something expensive. And actually, I'm looking forward to receiving the point.
Phoning something expensive?
Phone, like, you know, a chat line or...
Yeah. Like a hot chat line for medal winners.
Oh, like a Crossrail line where you can phone up and talk about Crossrail.
Please.
There is a line. There actually is a Crossrail line.
Jesus Christ, Jimmy.
There is.
Are you shitting me, mate? What would you encourage?
Rob, Richard, what did you put?
Well, possibly I thought he could have used the phone for collateral and then, you know, run up debt as a result of that. That if he borrowed on the phone and went into negative equity. Or... he used it as a weapon and had to pay damages.
OK, what did you put?
We just guessed a Pokemon Go.
100% right. 100% right. You got a £3,700 phone bill for playing Pokemon Go. Pokemon Go was obviously... it was the game of the year. Here's the Norwegian Prime Minister playing in their parliament. Their parliament looks a lot like a bingo hall, I think. And here's a news reporter who was caught playing Pokemon Go during a US State Department briefing.
As the secretary said earlier today, though, and I think it's an important reminder, you're playing the Pokemon thing right there, aren't you? It's an important reminder. We know this won't be easy. We recognize it's a challenge, and we're clear-eyed about the work we still have to do. This is why we convene this important ministerial, and we'll continue to work with our coalition partners to defeat Dash. Did you get one?
Signal is not very good.
Sorry about that.
So cool.
The thing is, though, it's not the fault of Pokemon Go. It's that this athlete didn't set up a proper roaming tariff.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it is annoying, isn't it, when you see, like, some kid goes on holiday with their family, they rack up, like, thousands of pounds, and then you see him in a newspaper going, absolutely disgraced by the phone bill I received. Don't be a knobhead.
Yeah.
If you're going abroad and then you're dicking around all this stuff, you're going to get a big fine. But you deserve it. In fact, they should double it for you going to the press. That's what I think should happen.
On board Crossrail carriages. If you want to catch the little characters, it will be easier on Crossrail.
Okay, I asked you what present Candice Payne bought herself. What did you put?
Oh, a Chewbacca mask.
Okay, Romesh Mel.
Yeah, Chewbacca mask.
So never stop doing that.
Says it all.
Rob, Richard, did you get this?
We said what they said. It was Chewbacca mask, lady.
Yeah, it's I think it really delivers. I think it's a genuine. Have a look.
I gotta take off my glasses for it. Oh, naturally. Okay, here we go. So. Yes! Now watch when my mouth actually moves. That's not me making that noise, it's the mask! Here, listen.
I've never been that happy in my life. I asked you why 86-year-old May Ashworth Google search history went viral this year. What did you put? What do you think, Sarah?
Well, it's because... Is it a grandson, isn't it? A grandson's very disrespectful and put her Google search up the internet, but the main reason was because she was very polite on it. She said please and thank you because she thought it was going to an actual person because she's really stupid. But, you know, mostly stupid.
Romesh, did you get this?
Yeah, the very polite Google search. Please, can you tell me where to find black guys? Thank you.
Rob, Richard?
Yeah.
Same deal.
Yeah, same. Yeah, very well. Points all round. Take a look. She was incredibly polite
and sweet. So
sweet. And Google UK thanked her, saying, in a world of billions of searches, yours made us smile. Aww. It's just so nice, please. We heard from OneRepublic, who asked you to name a new selfie pose that became popular on Instagram this year. What do you put?
We think that's not the right answer, don't we? That's what we
think. I sort of hope it's the answer.
Yeah.
Face fingering. Like, sort of, you know, like, no.
I mean, you definitely didn't need to do it, but, yeah, it's not face fingering. That's not what it's called. What did you get, Rob?
We said finger mouth, we called it.
Is that right?
I think that's near enough. Mel, Romesh?
We put finger mouth in, bruv.
Which is the old, you know, the...
I don't know. Let's take a look. Here's the queen of Instagram, Kylie Jenner. Finger mouthing is 100% right. Yeah, it's finger mouthing. Right, time now to welcome a special guest. It's Made in Chelsea's resident expert on etiquette, Mark Francis Vandelli.
Hello, Mark. How are you?
Good morning.
Very well indeed.
We look like a before and after, and it's
do we?
Yeah, it's plastic surgery, and obviously you're the after. Damn it. How's your year been? How's your?
Not that bad. Does it show?
No, not at all. You look fabulous. You were on the jump this year, weren't you?
I was. That was probably not the highlight of my year.
What did you break?
Lots of things, including my mind for a period of time, but my ankle mostly.
You've got a question for us. Go ahead.
I have got a question.
Okay.
So it probably won't come as a great surprise to you, but I'm a huge fan of art.
Yes, you are.
And I love discovering new iconic pieces.
Yeah, sure you do. Mm.
This year's Turner Prize nominations were announced in May, and artist Anthea Hamilton's piece, Project for a Door, received the most attention. Can you tell me why?
Is it to do with Crossrail, Mark?
I don't know what that is.
Do you think he's ever in his life got on a train? Come on, man.
I was just going to ask for the question again because I didn't quite understand you because you're so fucking posh.
That is a good point.
That's the wrong answer.
No, come on, let's have the question again. Okay, so... Yeah.
This year's Turner Prize nominations were announced in May, and artist Anthea Hamilton's piece...
Thank you.
...Project for a Door...
No need to be sarcastic, mate.
I'm not. But a hearing aid might be in order. Received the most attention.
I'll tell you what, mate, you're about to lose another ankle. You carry on giving it this shit.
And what was it like finding out you were related to Danny Dyer?
I realised I was probably related to royalty at that point.
Right? Yeah.
Are you related to royalty? I imagine you are.
Well, clearly, Danny Dyer is living proof that we all are.
Yeah.
Project for a Door.
Project for a Door. Why was it controversial? OK, so let's have a look at your answers. What did you get? OK, David and Sarah wrote...
It was nothing at all.
It was nothing at all.
The artwork was... It was called Project for a Door, and it was fuck all. Give me an award.
Like, OK, yeah. All right. Romesh, Mel?
Diana Dawes.
You thought it was Diana Dawes. Project for a Door was Diana Dawes. OK, Rob, Richard?
It was just a knob. But I wrote it sideways, like art.
Because it was just a knob.
Just a knob.
Well, tell us the answer.
No, I'm afraid, unbelievably, you're all wrong.
Tell us, Mark.
It was a watercolour of Cornwall. 10 metre high.
Crossrail. Was it a big train? Was it a train?
A pair of bottom cheeks that were being parted by a pair of hands and you could walk through them.
OK, well, let's have a look and see what that's done to the scores. So, I can tell you that Romesh and Mel have 15, Rob and Richard have 15 in the lead, David and Sarah with 18. Oh. We're going to take a short break now, but please give it up one more time for Mark Francis Vandelli. Thanks for coming in, Mark. Welcome back to the Big Fat Quiz of 2016. The next round is all about sport. 2016 was a great year for sport. Here are some of the winners and the losers. Russian athletes were banned from the Olympics because of widespread drug use. Suspicions were raised when some of the male athletes completed the pole vault without any equipment. Usain Bolt cemented his reputation with another 3 gold medals in Rio. I think I speak for everyone when I say I wish Usain Bolt was Russian. Imagine how fast he'd be on steroids. FIFA banned footballers from wearing poppies. If players defy the ban, I'm not sure what the penalties will be, but I'm pretty sure if they're penalties, England will miss them. Sport, everyone, some sports questions.
Okay. Sporty.
First up, it's over to comedy royalty. It's Miranda Hart.
Aww.
Hi, Jimmy. Now, on-set catering when filming can sometimes be a disaster, as Jeremy Clarkson knows only too well. But I'm always intrigued that athletes I thought would be given Michelin-starred meals when they were touring the world. However, this year, tennis champ Serena Williams admitted to sampling a rather unusual dish the day before a match at the Italian Open. It sent her running to the bathroom and she described it as a little bit like a house cleaner thing. What was it?
Okay. So Miranda wants to know what caused tennis legend Serena Williams to come down with an upset stomach during the Italian Open earlier this year. Okay. There was trouble at the Rio Olympics when the diving pool was forced to close. Can you remember why? Portugal won the European Championship final in July, beating France 1-0. But what unexpectedly happened to Cristiano Ronaldo after he was injured 17 minutes into the game?
He took a Crossrail train. And never came back. I don't know.
OK. In May, Leicester City beat the odds and stormed to victory to win the Premier League. During the season, their manager, Claudio Ranieri, revealed a motivational catchphrase he used during training. What was it?
Oh. Cross rail.
Okay, here are some answers. Yes. First up, Miranda asked you what caused Serena Williams to run to the bathroom. What did you think it was?
Did she eat her dog's dinner?
That's a very good answer. Romesh, Mel?
Sillet bang.
You thought she had sillet bang?
Well, because you mentioned the name of a household cleaner.
Yeah, that would give you an upset tummy. What do you put, Rob, Richard?
Her dog's salmon.
You are 100%. Well, let's take a look.
Thank you.
Oh, is the dog's
That is the dog's dinner that she ate. So in the hotel she was at, they did a dog menu. There was salmon and rice for dogs. And she thought, this looks nice. I'll try some. Take a look.
Let's fast forward to 2 hours. I just ran to the toilet like I thought I was gonna pass out. Like, it tastes a little bit like a house cleaner kind of thing. I don't know what they put in these dog food. I don't think it's consumable for humans. And they should have wrote that. I really don't feel so good. Oh, no.
When did everyone start filming themselves?
It's about 10 years ago.
All the time. Even while you're about to have violent diarrhea, you still go, let's make a record of this.
That last one, it looks like she's looking down at the mess she's just created.
OK, I asked you why they closed the diving pool at the Rio Olympics. What did you get?
Water went green.
Went green, bruv.
Yeah, the water changed colour.
Water changed colour, went green. And what have you put there, Rob, Richard?
The part we'd like you to read is the last part with a circle around it, which says colour, smell.
Oh, I put it rained blood.
You thought they closed the pool because it rained blood?
Well, you've got to close the pool. Start raining blood. And that's what turned the pool red. It rained, like in Carrie.
OK, points. Here's a picture. Yes, the water, of course, turned green. Apparently, someone had poured hydrogen peroxide into the diving well.
Via their hair?
No, someone poured it in.
Oh, right.
Why didn't it go blonde?
Exactly.
Yeah, should have gone blonde. OK, I asked you what happened to Cristiano Ronaldo 17 minutes into the European Championship final. David Mitchell, I imagine you got that.
Well, sports are our strong point.
No.
No.
Well, you're two for two so far.
Yeah, but this is proper sport.
Tennis players eating dog food. Is it sport or is it just current affairs?
It's between the two.
We think maybe he shatters self.
Yeah.
That feels like very much your answer because of the phrasing.
My answer?
Yeah. He shat himself.
I'm entirely behind the phrasing. Yeah, I think I support that phrasing because what it suggests is that he shat his whole self.
Yeah.
Romesh?
Moths on his face. There's a moth on his face, isn't there?
Moth on his face.
Or is it Motson, not John Motson? Motson or Motson?
Dude, seriously, can I trade?
Rob, Richard.
He got an erection that would not squash down.
Well, let's have a look.
He's shitting himself, isn't he, dude?
He's even got a little bit of shit on his face. That's how badly he's shat himself.
Well, I'm tempted to give you all points, but yes. It's a moth on his face is the answer.
Oh. Hey, nice one.
And what happened?
I'm going to remember that if I ever get shit on my face. I'll say, oh, it's a moth. Sorry, everyone, it's a moth. Don't look too closely, it's a moth. Let me just go to the loo and get rid of this moth.
OK. I asked you what motivational catchphrase Claudio Ranieri used to guide Leicester City to victory. What did you put?
We've put kicking in the goal. Because that would, you know, focus the minds of the players and make them realise what the aim of the... I think it's the aim of football, I'm not sure, to kick it in the goal.
I think you know that. I think for next season, that is what they'll be picking up on. OK, what have you gone for, Romesh Mel?
Please don't lose.
Wow, we've gone for racism.
Now, that was no worse than xenophobia, be fair.
I was just giving it a bit of character.
Yes. So, what was the phrase?
Please don't lose.
Rob, Richard?
Do we have to read
yes.
this? Win, please.
You've all gone with very similar themes.
So, Jimmy, which of us is right?
Let's go over to the man himself.
Danny Drinkwater has said this week that he was asked about how you are with the players, and he says you have an imaginary bell that you shake if you don't think you've got their full attention.
No, because from the beginning, no, when something was wrong, I say, hey, dilly-din, dilly-don, wake up, wake up. during all the training sessions, sometimes dilly-din, dilly-don, and on Christmas Day I said, okay, I bought for all the player, all the staff, to everybody, a little bell, dilly-din, dilly-don. And just
dilly-ding, dilly-don.
Dilly-ding, dilly-don. Dilly-ding,
dilly-don.
Si dice così in italiano, dilly-din, dilly-don. That's what they say.
For just speaking in another language.
No, you're racist for turning up at my house in a KKK outfit, all right? That's why you're racist.
I'm
throwing dog shit at my house.
That's a very feminine snort there, Mel. Very ladylike,
Because she could have been throwing that dog shit just because she hates you.
Yeah, that's... That is true. That's
for who you are.
That's a very good point.
And don't rule that out. Never rule out the possibility that people hate you for who you are inside.
You guys look as if you just had amazing sex. You just look as if you've just...
I like how you take your clothes off after sex.
Oh, no.
We've had sex, now I might loosen a button.
Just strapping up again.
You know my favourite bit when you threw that shit at me.
Okay. Okay, time for a quick bonus round. It's Say What You See. I'm going to show you three Say What You Sees. Each one is an important but boring headline from 2016. All you have to do is work them out, okay? Here's the first one. They're all important stories, but they are boring. Okay, you got it?
Yep.
Next one, here you go. Say what you see. Just say what you see. It couldn't be easier.
Panama.
You got to get it quietly. Okay, third one. Boring, but important. Richard, Rob, write down something. I'm chivvying you. It is official. You're being chivvied.
Yes.
No chivvying needed here.
You're a very good boy, David. Well
Thank
done you.
You.
Sarah, you're very good.
I like to think we're unbearably smug.
Well, you are correct. Okay. All right, have you all got something?
Yep.
All right, so here's the first one. What did you put, Romesh, Mel?
We put Article 50 net case.
Well, I thought it must be Article 50 triggered, but I couldn't make net and case become triggered.
Is it, is it just a tennis net you're looking at?
Court. Court case! Article 50 court case.
Well, why are you high-fiving? You didn't get
it. Get it.
Well, we did just then.
After Jimmy gave us the answer, we managed to figure it out. Who gives a shit? We've lost the point.
To be fair, Jimmy actually encouraged Mel to make a deductive leap.
Yes.
She made the leap.
Thank you.
And then you crushed her, which I think was cruel.
Thank you.
Very weird.
We had Article 50 court case.
Okay, cool. And did you get that, David?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so points,
case.
No points.
Oh,
okay.
So close.
All right, what did you put for the next one? Come on,
Panama
now.
Paper leak.
Panama paper leak. Did you get this, Rob, Richard?
Hot medieval leak. Which you can type that,
armor?
You can type that into the internet.
Oh, armor. Because I say armor wrong. Pan armor, but it's Panama.
To be honest, no one says armor like the second two syllables of Panama.
No, it's not how we say it. It's a bit of a leap, but you know, it's one of those. So, did you get this, Sarah?
Panama papers leak.
Okay. Final one. Did you get this?
Yeah.
What did you get, Romesh?
Chilcot Inquiry.
Chilcot Inquiry. Okay, David, Sarah?
Same.
Yeah.
Okay, Rob, Richard?
Well, I don't know what ecstasy looks like, so I just wrote some kind of village massacre.
Some kind of village massacre.
I don't know. Yeah. Why are you expecting me to know what E looks like? I'm not Irvin Welsh.
All right, time for another bonus round. It's time for the part of the show where I introduce a mystery guest. All you have to do is guess who they are and how they made the news this year. But you can only ask yes or no questions. Please welcome our mystery guest. First things first, can I just confirm with you, you're not in the vamps? No. OK, not in the vamps. OK, so you can ask him yes or no questions. Go.
Is it sport-related?
Yes.
Is it Olympic-related?
Yes.
Were you in Rio?
No.
Mm.
Were you elsewhere?
clothed?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm done.
Are you related to the British table tennis player, Drinkle?
Drinkle?
Jesus Christ! I
mean, prepare yourself for a crossroad question. It's coming.
Can we get a clue?
Okay, it was an event that took place in Manchester.
No, it took place in Rio. Is it a drinking game?
No.
Were you drunk at the time?
Yeah. Kind of.
Yeah.
Kind of.
Yeah. Oh, is it something to do with bicycles?
No. No. It is to do with a mode of transport.
Bus?
It's to do with a bus.
We got it. We got it, bro.
You've got it.
We got it, bro.
Yeah.
OK, all right, let's have a look. What have you got, David, Sarah?
We put, he pretended to be an Olympian and crashed the parade.
OK, Romesh, Mel?
He got on the GB Olympic team bus pretending to be a GB Olympian.
OK, and you've got Rob, Richard?
I don't know and neither does Rob.
Yes.
I mean, the thing is...
That is undoubtedly correct.
It's my truth.
OK, tell us.
So, my name's Zach Allsop and I blagged my way onto the Olympic homecoming parade in Manchester.
That's pretty good. So you're an Olympic blagger, Olympic level blagging.
Yeah,
huge. OK, I think we've got a little bit of footage of you.
A couple of blaggers, aren't you?
Absolutely. Yeah, blag something every now and then, but right. We're going to get off at the next
stop.
Well,
we've got to get off.
It's pretty quality. Yeah, pretty good. Pretty good level of blagging. So, what event did you claim to be?
So we went with fencing because we figured it was one of the least recognised sports. So...
And how did you get caught out?
Because we got on the bus with the fences.
OK, let's see how you're all doing. OK, I can tell you that, the scores at the moment, Rob and Richard have 18, Romesh and Mel have 20 in the lead, David and Sarah with 24 points. We're going to take a quick break now, but please give it up one more time for Olympic blagger Zach Allsop. Thanks for coming on, Zach. Welcome back to the Big Fat Quiz of 2016. Our next round is all about people. Let's remind ourselves of some of the movers and shakers who made 2016 so memorable. After admitting to an affair, Ozzy Osbourne walked out on Sharon. While I say walked out, he sort of shuffled off mumbling. Mother Teresa was declared a saint by Pope Francis. So basically, a man in charge of a made-up religion gave a made-up award to a woman after she made up a couple of miracles. She must have been made up. Theresa May became Prime Minister in July, and she's brought a much-needed feminine touch to slashing benefits. OK, time for some more questions. Taylor Swift and Tom Hiddleston became a couple back in June and were immediately known as Hiddleswift. How did Tom make his affection for Taylor clear when they were snapped frolicking in the sea on Independence Day?
It wasn't an erection that wouldn't swap.
For our next question, it's over to one of Britain's finest thespians, Mr. Charles Dance, who's reading an extract from an autobiography released in 2016 by a much-loved star. Who is the mystery author? Over to Charles.
Chapter 9. It was hashtag nerve-wrack. No full group had gone through previously. You're ill, I randomly exclaimed. My head was all over the shop. I'd done it. I was through to the next and final part of boot camp. As I scurried off the stage, Nicole was putting her thumbs up and smiling at me. Something that didn't make the TV edit was the following thing I shouted. As I noticed her clearly showing her happiness I was through, I went to shout out the words pussycat dolls. But what actually ended up coming out of my mouth still haunts me to this day. I opened my mouth, put my thumbs up towards her, and shouted at the top of my voice, "Pussy!" I was mortified. Had I just shouted the word "pussy" at the top of my voice directly at Nicole Scherzinger's face? Yeah, yeah, I had. Absolute fail.
Charles Dance there, one of the greatest actors of his generation, shouting the word pussy. OK, so whose autobiography was he reading from? Which work of literature have we chosen to feature this year?
In the literature round.
Of the Big Fat Quiz. This year, 26-year-old Ben Innes became notorious for posting a photo whilst on a flight to Cairo. What was so remarkable about the photo?
Is this age relevant?
No. No, and you know what? His name isn't that relevant.
Yeah.
This year, a man on a plane to Cairo. Actually, the destination's not that important. So this year, a man on a plane. It doesn't matter that it's a plane. This year, a photo. There was a photo. This year, there was a photo. What was remarkable about it?
Thank you.
And finally, it's over to everyone's favourite synth from Humans. It's Gemma Chan.
Hi, Jimmy. Now, Humans was one of the year's biggest sci-fi dramas, but that's nothing compared to the real-life sci-fi adventures of Tim Peake, who returned home in June after spending 6 months aboard the International Space Station. But can your teens remember what he described being back on Earth as feeling like?
She said it's real-life sci-fi.
Real-life science fiction.
Yeah, that's a contradiction in terms. Fiction. Can't have real-life fiction. Well, I suppose it's real, but then all science fiction in that it exists in real life.
Mel...
But it does not depict real life.
Are you doing... David's whittering on about something. What are you...
I'm paid to whitter on about something.
I know. I didn't want to interrupt, but what have you got?
I've brought us both a picnic.
Oh. What did you bring?
Two tomatoes, two custard creams, some finger sandwiches.
What are the sandwiches?
Peanut butter, my love. Want one?
Oh, I'd love one.
Holy shit, this is incredible.
It's a proper school trip pack lunch.
Yes.
But...
What's this?
Bloody hell!
What's that, man?
Little drinkies.
What have you got?
Brandy.
Why have you got brandy in a...
Well, it's nice to have a little, you know, snifter. Of an evening.
Well, it's Christmas, I'm sure. You're drinking responsibly.
And have a little splash of the brandy if it's...
Splash of brandy. I've got a little blanket as well. I've got one for you and one for me.
All right. I asked you if you could remember how Tom Hiddleston advertised his feelings for Taylor Swift. What did you put?
With a shirt.
And I put with an erection that wouldn't squash down.
Well, I'm sure within the privacy of their own home. Romesh Mel?
It was a T-shirt. And I seem to remember it said, I heart TS on it.
OK, and you got...
Same
T-shirt
same.
Saying, I heart TS, yeah.
I thought that was a T.S. Eliot reference.
Well, let's have a look. Absolutely right, yeah, there he is. That is not his... That is a bad fit.
He's totally written himself out of being James Bond, hasn't he?
And is it you that makes that decision, Mel?
Awesome. You'll be involved.
Yeah.
Myself. It's great.
It looks to me now, Romesh, like this camping trip wasn't your idea, but you're going along with it.
I fucking hate camping.
How does this compare to going on holiday with your mum?
This is better because my mum's not here.
Oh, bless you. OK. Points all round on that, obviously. Charles Dance read an extract from a celebrity autobiography. Who did you think he was reading from? So, Romesh Mel.
We put Zayn.
Zayn Malik from One Direction?
Yeah.
Exactly.
No. 100% wrong. Rob, what did you put?
Donald Trump.
You thought that was in Donald Trump's autobiography when he was going through to boot camp?
No. It was the long shout of the word pussy.
I don't think he would characterise shouting pussy as a fail, though, would he?
The thing with Trump that's quite odd is that he'll interrupt himself while he's speaking to agree with himself. Have you noticed that?
Yep.
It's a very odd thing. He goes, we've got to do this, very important. He actually heckles himself positively. Got to do it, it's very important. Thank you, Don.
Sarah?
It's a guess. Is it Ryland Clark?
Well, let's go back over to Charles Dance to see.
That was an extract from The Life of Ryland by Ryland Clark Neal. Drop me out.
Charles Dance, everyone. God bless you. OK, next I wanted to know how a picture of Ben Innes became so notorious this year.
Because he took it with a guy that hijacked a plane. It was a selfie with a suspected hijacker.
OK, and what did you put, Rob?
We put the same. He was with a hijacker.
OK, David, Sarah?
We said, yes, he took a selfie with a hijacker.
Well, let's have a look. I mean, this is the photo he had taken.
In the
hijacker's defense, he just wanted to go see his ex-wife, which I think is charming, and I think most of the ladies here would agree that they'd love it if their guy did that.
You've really captured the mood. Yeah, you've really read the room. Those were fake explosives as well. He was kind of bullshitting, but he wanted the plane to divert to go and see his ex-wife. OK, so, well, you all got that. Well done. OK. Gemma Chan asked you how Tim Peake described being back on Earth after 6 months in space. What did you put?
Tim Peake remarked on the smell of the Earth, how it smelled so strong.
Bit rude. Stinks down here. I prefer space. I'm amazing. It stinks down here. That's what he's basically implying, isn't he? Yeah. With that.
I've been in a tin of my own farts for 6 months.
Exactly.
It's better than this.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we've just about had it up to here with astronaut Tim Peake and how he hates the planet Earth and can barely bear to set foot on it.
And now carry me around in a throne.
Yeah, absolutely.
When I deign to land
and
be among you.
You all smell. I'm going to fuck off back to the... to the stratosphere as soon as I can.
Oh, I'm Tim Peake and I'm too good for gravity. Honestly. Piss off.
Yeah. Well, what did you put, Rob Richard?
Hangover.
I put a massive ball ache.
What did you put, David?
Hangover.
Hangover. Well, you're all absolutely right. Yes, he said it was like the worst hangover ever and he said it smelt very strong. Points all round. OK, we've got a special guest coming on now. Mel, can you clean up?
Oh, sorry, love.
It's the one and only Pamela Anderson. Yay! Hello. How are you? Nice to see you.
Nice to
see you. Excellent. Yeah, you think you're getting hot under the colour. Christ. How was your 2016?
Oh, it was great. I mean, it was a good year for big animals, wasn't it? The SeaWorld stopped breeding orcas and Ringling Brothers retired their elephants.
Did they?
Yes, they did.
Huge.
Because yes, that's good news.
It's good, right?
That's good news.
And that's your thing, isn't it?
That's you... my thing, animals.
Yeah.
But, you know, and watching my kids grow up, now they're 19 and 20, and
you've got kids of 19 and 20?
Yes, I do. And I don't know what to do with myself anymore. I'm wandering around, lost all over the place.
Pamela.
They don't need me.
Crossrail.
Go on, Crossrail. It's an amazing sort of technological adventure.
I don't know how best to explain. Okay. Mel's having a sort of mini breakdown, but... But you've got a question for us. Go on, what's your question?
Okay.
Tell us.
This year, Hillary Clinton, Paul McCartney, Honey G, Adele, and the England football team all took part in one of the big trends of the year. But can you tell me what it was they did?
OK, so they all did one thing.
Yes.
Do you know who Honey G is?
No.
Oh, yes, for the best. Have you all written something down?
Yeah.
Richard, Rob, what do you think?
Well, I put genocide.
You got all of those people, Honey G and the England football team, were somehow involved in a genocide.
I didn't want to rule it out.
Richard fell down and hit his head during the break, and what he meant was the mannequin challenge.
Ah, OK. And then, Mel, what did you put?
Crossrail.
You thought they were all involved in...
Somehow.
And Sarah, David?
We put the mannequin challenge.
Oh, we'll tell them the answer. What is the answer?
It's the mannequin challenge.
Yeah.
Oh. Points, points. No points. We should probably attempt a mannequin challenge now. Audience, are you up for this?
Yeah. Do they know what it is?
I mean, some of them will. I mean, they'll get the gist of it. They've just got to sit still. They'll be doing that all night. They'll be fine. Okay, so pick a pose, and then you've got to. Oh, Mel. Right. Mel is killing it. Okay.
Ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. I was born ready.
Are you doing it?
I was born ready. I sort of look half like a mannequin the whole time.
This is terrible. This is a terrible... This is like a rubbish version of The Matrix.
I'm never going to wash again. I've never been happy. OK, let's see what that's done to the scores. So, Rob and Richard, you've got 22. Romesh and Mel, you've got 23. Yes. David and Sarah, you've got 29. We're going to take a quick break now. Please give it up for the one and only Pamela Anderson, everyone. Yay! Thanks for coming on. Whoa! Welcome back to the Big Fat Quiz of the Year. The final round is all about the water cooler moments of 2016. Here's a reminder of what we were talking about this year. In 2016, both America and the UK were beset by creepy killer clowns. The difference was we didn't put ours in charge of the country. In March, Rupert Murdoch married Jerry Hall. Some raised eyebrows at the age gap, but Jerry Hall says she just likes his company, which is handy, because in about 6 months, she's going to own it. Our junior doctors went on strike. The junior doctors say changes to working hours would have left them dangerously tired, meaning during operations, they'd be more likely to hit the metal bit and make the red nose buzzer light up. OK, final set of questions. First up, over to Michelle Keegan, who's got a question for you.
Hi, Jimmy. I love having a good clear out at home, and I always donate to charity shops whenever I do. But this year, a branch of Oxfam in Swansea received so many donations of one particular item that they had to ask people not to give them any more. But can your teams remember what that was?
So Michelle wants to know what item a branch of Oxfam asked people to stop donating. I give you a clue, it was a book. It's a literature question, David. You should get this.
You're probably right. Yeah.
Have a look at this picture of Ed Sheeran. How did he get this injury?
Oh, shit.
Okay, what received a 10% reduction this year, causing a national outrage and prompting John Prescott to tweet, Brexit just got real? I can tell you, it was not Crossrail.
Am I the only person that doesn't give a shit about the train that goes that way?
No.
Just like trains that go that way. Sorry. Not sorry. Couldn't give a flying fuck, love.
I've been on a train with Mel, and you were very excited about it.
I was. I love trains and I love infrastructure.
Trip.
Imagine Acton Mainline.
Yes.
Romesh, do not take your own life. Next up, look at this picture of a Burger King employee in South Korea clearing a table very carefully. All I want to know is, why the protective gear?
Oh,
Rob's got one.
Do you?
Good, right?
Rob is a machine.
And lastly, it's over to everyone's favourite 80s pop star, Rick Astley.
Hi, Jimmy. Now, you've got to be tough to survive in the music business, but this year, one everyday object was given a rugged makeover, meaning it could withstand a spin in the washing machine, a red wine spillage, and survive temperatures of up to 120 degrees Celsius. Can your teams remember what it is?
Oh, come on, what is it?
Yes. What were you saying about Acton Mainline and Paddington?
No, dude, this ain't the time for that shit. We've got to get an answer down.
Mel, talk to me.
No, dude.
Mel, focus, write something down. What kind of makeover? What do you... Household object, just everyday object. Down.
Sorry.
Dude, okay. She's writing Acton Mainline.
There we go, I put Acton Mainline. That's silly. Household object, come on, quickly.
Okay.
Glove, a glove.
It's quite early onset, though, isn't it?
Rubber glove. Rubber glove.
Yeah, all right, everyone got some answers?
Yep.
OK, so Michelle Keegan asked you what a branch of Oxfam stopped taking donations of this year. What did you think?
50 Shades of Grey.
Ditto.
Ditto.
Well, you're all absolutely correct. They were so inundated, they built a fort. Take a look. Oh. It's one charity shop.
Did the pages all open? Are they all a bit stuck?
That fort must absolutely reek, mate.
Are you suggesting that people are literally ejaculating into the book? Because I haven't read this book.
I haven't read it either.
Well, read it and you'll fuck it.
Hey, that's the pull quote they want. Read it, I fucked it.
And so points all around there. I asked you how Ed Sheeran sustained his injury. What do you think?
We've got Princess Beatrice cut him with a sword during a fake knighting.
That is exactly right. Romesh, Mel, did you get this?
Yeah, ditto.
Ditto.
Princess. OK, fine. Yeah. Rob, Richard?
We disagreed. You went.
I wrote Princess Beatrice and then I drew a very good sword.
And I thought a tiny Ed Sheeran burst out of his cheek.
Incorrect. But you got Princess Beatrice. I'll give you that. Yeah. Yes, Princess Beatrice was actually pretending to knight James Blunt and Ed Sheeran was behind her and she caught him with a sword and cut his face.
Interestingly, the sword was not blunt.
Oh. Jesus.
Look, just
Giedroyc, everyone. Love Giedroyc. I asked you what received 10% reduction this year, causing a national outrage and prompting John Prescott to tweet, Brexit just got real. What did you think?
I put Crossrail.
Even though Jimmy said it's not Crossrail.
I put Crossrail.
She thought that was a red herring.
OK, what did you put, Rob?
Toblerone shrinkage.
And David?
And the answer is Toblerone, not Toblerone shrinkage. Toblerone shrinkage experienced a 100% increase in the last year, not a 10% reduction.
Could you just say the question again so that I can work out whether I give a shit?
I'll do better than that. I'll tell you, you definitely don't. You can have it, you can have it, yes.
Okay.
Points, points, no points. I mean, you can see what they've done there. That is quite sneaky.
I don't see any difference in them at all.
Wow.
Well, yeah, but you are hammered.
Are you, I mean, look at the size of that gap. You could drive a bloody Crossrail train through that.
I asked you why a South Korean Burger King employee was using protective gear to clear a table. What did you put?
Because they're vegan. And they don't want to touch the meat.
Rob, Richard.
Yeah, we thought that was a Samsung Galaxy phone, exploding phone.
Romesh Mel?
Samsung 7 exploding.
Well, let's take a look. It was, of course, a Samsung Galaxy Note 7 burning. And finally, Rick Astley asks you which object received a makeover, meaning it can now withstand red wine, a spin in the wash, and up to 120 degrees of heat. What have you all got?
Cats. It would be good to have a cat that could go in the wash machine, because they sometimes smell a bit, so...
And have red wine spilt on it, and be able to withstand 120 degree heat.
There you go. So you could send them into burning buildings to fetch things.
Yeah, because they're famously easy to give instructions to, cats.
Well, it would be a start. It's better than having a cat that would go in and just die.
Okay, it's a great cat rescue system you've come up with. Yeah. I'm disappointed to tell you you're 100% wrong.
That was terrible.
Rob, Richard.
The new fiver.
Yeah. The new £5 note.
Oh.
Mel, Romesh, did you definitely get it?
Yeah.
We put mug.
A mug. They invented a mug this year that could withstand red wine.
Yes, that is...
That's all mugs. All mugs ever. OK, so no points, no points, point. Well done, gang.
Well done.
OK. OK, the quiz is almost over. It all comes down to the big question. OK, so I'm looking for three things here. There's a point for each, and if you get all three, I'll give you a big, fat 10 bonus points.
Anyone could win.
OK, so I want to know, what was the biggest-selling album released in 2016? According to the official chart company. OK. I want to know, what was the most watched TV programme of the year? Most watched TV programme of the year. And finally, what was the word of the year, according to the Collins Dictionary?
Word?
A new word, yeah, word of the year. Oh. They always pick a new word as their word of the year. OK, all right. You written something down, Mel?
Yeah.
OK, all right. Well, let's have a look at your answers. What did you get? Rob and Richard first, what have you got?
Black Star.
Yeah, Black Star by Bowie.
What did you get, Mel?
Bowie Black Star.
OK, and what did you get, Sarah, David?
David Bowie's last album.
Yeah. OK, TV programme?
Final of Bake Off, or Bake Off in general.
What did you put, Mel?
I put Bake Off.
You put Bake Off?
I did a little picture of a cake and then I put Dash Off.
OK, I mean, you know, check bake yourself off before you wreck yourself. I mean, you're right, but it's pretty big-headed is all I'm saying.
It smugly.
Sounds like you maybe did.
She was so arrogant, mate. The way she
was.
She was like, no doubt about
this. We absolutely smashed it. And then she wrote it
down. Okay, Rob, Rich, did you get Bake Off?
Bake Off.
We did, yeah.
Yeah.
Bake Off, okay, highest rated show. Okay, finally, I asked you, what was the word of the year? What did you put, Mel, Romesh?
Blag.
I think blag was the word of the year.
I don't, but that's what she put.
Okay, Rob, Richard, what did you put as the word of the year?
Brexit.
Is that? Once we're in there, it's just scribble, isn't it?
Something happened here, but that's not a word.
Yeah, that's what
And then emerging from it, like a birth, is the new word of the year, Brexit.
OK, David, Sarah?
Brexit.
Brexit.
But you can quite clearly read, I think you'll find.
Yes, I mean, you got them all right. You got them all right, and you didn't get them all right. So, 2 points, 13 points, 13 points. Right, that's it. Time to work out your scores at home. Let's see how this lot did. I can tell you the score. Final scores are with 28 points in last place.
This is Romesh and Mel.
Rob Delaney, Richard Ayoade with 40 points came in second. But the winners of the Big Fat Quiz of 2016, David Mitchell and Sarah Millican. Here's your beautiful trophy. Beautiful. A big thanks to our amazing panel, all our special guests, and thank you for watching. That's it from us. Good night.
Well, new series, new hosts, new captains. The only thing that's remained is the title E4 tomorrow night at 10 for Wholly New Virtually Famous. And off on our jollies next Monday, swapping the restaurant for a luxury French retreat, literally going the extra mile for love at the First Dates Hotel. That's at 10. Just the right amount of cheese. Next, though, Anna Kendrick and Rebel Wilson star in Pitch Perfect.